Hello and namaste to all. I'm Ramya from ICCW. I welcome you all again in this webinar series. Thank you for joining us. Professor Pradeep has scaled water from a triatomic molecule in all its wondrous properties to the only known amrit to us. His research team is providing us drinking water to over 10 million people across India. Notwithstanding the good work, we still have a long journey ahead, delivering and implementing the right to clean water. As it is, the pre-COVID period was facing water stress everywhere. We are not sure if the SDG goals will be met before it's not too late or for too many people. In this new norm, the water challenges are many, and they are going to multiply in every turn. It is in this context we are having this webinar, trying to discover solutions to these challenges, reassess these solutions, and make them sustainable. In this context, our theme today is detergents and chemicals for disinfection. Our moderator for the evening is Mr. Sripathi Kaulagi, our expert engineer at ICCW, and he will take you through the event. Now I request Professor Pradeep to deliver the welcome address. On to you, Professor.
Welcome to this webinar and second symposium of the series. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. This symposium series was inaugurated last week on May 7, 2020 by Mr. Parameshwaran Iyer, Secretary of the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. At its peak, we had more than 670 participants in the last symposium. That symposium was put together in just 4 days, and I was excited to see the fantastic response. Thank you for joining if you were at the symposium. On today's symposium, we have now 418 strong network of thought leaders and future leaders. We hope to have about 600 or so people at the symposium. In fact, we have kept live streaming of the event in YouTube so that more people can participate in it. We have a fantastic set of speakers and excellent panelists. In fact, the best that country can assemble. They range from finest toxicologists to the very best industrial experts and surfactant scientists. I will keep my talk short, as I would like you to have time for questions, as many as possible. This conference is organized by ICCW, International Center for Clean Water. It's an initiative of IIT Madras to ensure that the world is water secure. ICCW is a place where anyone can come and build a water technology from scratch and implement it in the field. It's a place where water technologies built here and at other places can be implemented in the field. It's a place to train water professionals of tomorrow. As you all know, water is chemistry, it is physics, biology, agriculture, engineering, health, biodiversity, incubation, etc. Therefore, ICCW is an interdisciplinary center. Please do visit us if you come to Chennai, or visit us virtually. This conference is a platform to interact. Please write down your thoughts and ensure that power of thinking can indeed transform the world. Probably, this is the first time in history when the world has come to a standstill with something we can't even see. However, most of you who have joined us are young. That makes it certain that we will come out of this crisis as well. Nations are trying to wash this virus off from the planet. That's also a problem handled by surfactants. Science of surfactants is quite big. There's a lot of physics, chemistry, and biology in that. The global consumption of detergents is about 11.9 kilograms per person and about 85 million tons per year. It's about 30 million tons of this as powdered detergent.
Professor's video stopped, Ramya.
Yes, I believe he must have some connectivity issue. Can we just wait for a minute and see if he's joining back?
He's just joining in 2 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
Ramya, let's move on.
Okay, sir. I would like you to take over, sir, Shripati.
Thank you, Professor Pradeep, for the welcome remarks. Now it's my privilege to welcome all our panelists and. I would do a moderating role here with introducing the speaker and the speaker would make his presentation. There are four speakers today. We have Professor Alok Dhawan and we have Dr. Nimish Shah, Dr. Venkat Raghavan and Mr. Venkatesh Devasikamani. So the agenda is already circulated to all of us, but nevertheless, we will start with Professor Alok Dhawan, who would be enlightening us on the disinfectants through the routes of detergents. What are the sustainable methods for disinfection through disinfection? And Professor Alok Dhawan, as you have been seeing, his profile. He started in the area of nanomaterial toxicology in India and published a guidance document on the safe use of nanomaterials. And you name any society, any academy, he's been a fellow. And I don't want to waste more time in introducing him. I would request Professor Dhawan to get on to his presentation. Thank you, Professor. Pramya, can you change the slides? Professor Dhawan, please.
Yes, please. Thank you. So it's just a little bit, the title is a little bit away from the program that was circulated, but I thought it'd be a good idea to look at what are the innovative methods, especially within the country, that have been developed either by the industry or by institutions or by a combination of both. and how we can reduce the detergents. One, second, how we can maximize the disinfection, and third, how are these methods more sustainable? So the discussion that we are having today, like Professor Pradeep mentioned in his opening remarks, is more of a platform to discuss thoughts that can be taken forward. And since people from all over the world have joined, and I did see some professor from Tokyo as well. So I think it is fantastic that this platform is providing us thought leaders from across the world working in this area, who are interested in this area, who have something or the other to contribute. So I'll just go through these slides. Ramya, would you be able to change them for me? And just, yeah. So essentially what we're looking at are three things. One, of course, to do an effective management of the water that goes out, how we can reduce the water, how, and thereby reducing the amount of wastewater that is going out. As Pradeep again mentioned, that the water is in short supply, so we need to do that. Second, of course, the effectiveness of the treatment. And third, how to make it sustainable as per the SDG goals. So next, please. So this was something that I thought I should discuss with you. One is, of course, the mist, and all these are developed indigenously. Second is the electrostatic sprayer, which has been developed by CSIO. We have used electrolysis for disinfection of water, which I'll discuss in a slide. Then we have ultrasonication, again, something which we have done together with the company in our institute itself. And finally, how we contain disinfection using microwave. So I think these are some of the technologies I thought worth discussing with you. So I'll go to the next slide. So if you look at the mist, these are very simple sort of nozzles that are now available in the market. You can actually change these nozzles in the existing taps. And as they claim, they almost save up to 90% of water with the same amount of wetness that you can get on your hands. So thereby you reduce the water that goes down the drain, and it is getting sort of contaminated with either the detergents or otherwise. On the detergent side, I would say there are companies that are coming up with new detergents that do not froth as much, and so therefore require less water to wash your clothes as well. There are other chemicals that are being added to detergents so that they can give you a better wash and can also take care. So essentially detergents wash off the substrate, not necessarily they will disinfect, right? So these are two different things and one needs to understand. So may I have the next slide, please? This was something that got developed by CSIO Chandigarh, which is a CSR lab. It's an electrostatic disinfection machine. It was developed for altogether a different objective earlier, but since it's a platform technology, CSIR was able to modify it, and now it is taken up by BHEL as a electrostatic disinfection machine for COVID spraying. And you can actually use disinfectants in this machine to spray various hospital and other areas that you wish. Next, please. Similarly, we took up water as a challenge a couple of years back, and we developed a machine which does not require either chemicals or membranes to disinfect the water. And this is purely based on electrolysis. It's a patented technology of the institution, and it is very affordable. And it has now gone commercial. Two of the companies have taken up the license now, and the cost, as you can see, in terms of India is pretty low. It's approximately 1 to 2 paisa per liter. And the best part is that it can be run in terms of sustainability. It can be run both the machines, this community-based system that you're seeing here, as well as the home system, both can be run on solar power. So I think that is the beauty of this machine. And it is scalable. It's modular in nature. It's scalable from 5,000 liters per day to almost 1 lakh liters per day. And it is 100% IoT enabled and totally automated. And one of the licensees actually providing almost 10 years warranty on this machine. So that's how rugged these devices have been made in the country. Next, please. Similarly, this is another machine, which is, again, we're trying to save water. So this was a concept that was developed by one of our incubatees, who's also part of the panel. And they came up with a design that why can't we use microwave-based disinfection rather than doing autoclaving for biomedical waste? And that's how we started. And so essentially we were looking at not only reducing the water that is required, but also the time. And so therefore we sort of developed along with them, we added a lot of things to this machine. And ultimately now we have also been able to prove that this microwave based machine can actually disinfect the N95 masks. We are still awaiting the results for COVID on N95, but N95 per se can be disinfected with bacterial strains that were used, and it still remains the same. So the sturdiness is still the same, everything else is the same. And I think it's a fantastic idea how to disinfect. I think that's how we are moving forward. People are now even thinking of using microwave, if possible, to disinfect bigger areas like labs. UVC has been used to disinfect labs already now. Next, please. This is another product which is not from the country, but I was quite impressed with the system per se. You put in your hands into this device. This is a self-contained device which rinses your hands first through a mist of water, and then they have their own patented technology with which they clean. And again, a mist of water comes, all within 12 seconds, and uses 75% less water. But I thought, although in terms of the cost, I would say it's not very cost effective, but I think in terms of where it can be used, especially in the hospitals or in COVID wards, I thought it was a fantastic technology where you can actually, without touching anything, you can actually clean your hands, and it is, and the entire system is self-contained. So the water does not go down into the drain. So I think this again is something that we should think of, especially in the times to come, how we can reuse the water. Can it be used within the homes itself? And I'll allude to that a little bit later. Next, please. So this is something that is kind of a wild thought that I had, and I thought I should place it before the audience. Below the sink, we have these kind of the joints that you see. And is it possible that we have a contraption beneath the sink that takes away majority of the organics and let the water, in a sense, semi-purified right there below the sink, so that the water goes out, we have much better quality of water than we have now that is going down the drain. So is it possible to have small units fitted on the sink, especially in bigger areas like restaurants, etc., that can be treated there and then? And so we reduce, on the one hand, we take the mist and we reduce the amount of water that is going down. On the other hand, we also capture back the chemicals, etc., that are going into the drain, and that reduces the load on the environment. Next, please. This is again something, a technology that I was quite impressed with. This is again indigenous technology. What I'm given to understand is still not patented. It is a trade secret, but they are using different kinds of hydroperoxides and superoxides to disinfect water and to clean water. And in fact, they've used it even for sewage treatment, etc. And you can see the two bottles. One is absolutely black and the other one is transparent. So I think that is the level of cleanliness that this product can do. And we've had some discussions with them as to how to develop it further. I think these are, again, solutions that we need to ensure that when they go into the environment, they are eco-friendly in nature and can not only treat the effluents easily, but can also be eco-friendly and do not damage the environment. Next, please.
Sir, we have 2 minutes.
Yeah, that's the last slide. Next, please. Yeah. So I think what we need to be thinking, of course, one is the bio-based natural formulations that can be used for treatment of water and for disinfection, rather than using chemicals on surfaces. Second are nano formulation that can enhance the efficacy. And third, as I mentioned, can we use activated carbon or water-free cleaning system? That would be really remarkable. I mean, can we just get rid of everything on our hands without using water? So it is like, is it possible that we can do a COVID test just on a plain strip of paper without using any machine? So one has to really think beyond what is available now. And I think these will be the challenges that we move forward with. Next, please. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Professor. It was a good learning for us in trying to understand the several ways of reducing, reusing, and recycling the disinfection or disinfectant disinfectants that are getting into the stream. And definitely, we are looking forward to trying out some of these quickly in the next couple of weeks or so. So in between these presentations, I'm bound to say something in terms of the number of participants who have been logged in as of now. It's around 564 and 567. It's between these two numbers, and we hope this will go up. And thank you, Professor, for accepting our request and sharing your thoughts on this. Hope we had the participants had a good understanding on the several disinfection systems. And I would request Dr. Nimisha, our next speaker, who's the Managing Director, Toilet Board India Chapter. And he has been in the sustainable business for the past 25 years and a part of Unilever earlier. And he has been spearheading several activities on end-to-end innovation and R&D leadership. And he has deep expertise in areas of sustainable innovation, water sanitation, food safety, health and hygiene. He has many credits to him in terms of publications and so on, and the patents. And he has authored a book, Swachh Bharat for Swasth Bharat, Clean India for Healthy India. I would not take much time. I would request Dr. Nimisha to do his presentation. In the meantime, I would request all the participants to keep noting down some questions and put it on the Q&A box there. We will try and answer some of them.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I am really very pleased to come to this forum. I heartiest congratulations to Professor Pradeep and his team for planning this event. And I was impressed by the kind of work ICCW is doing in the area of water. I also saw some visuals with those were very impressive. Also pleased to see friends and former colleagues contributing to this initiative. So a big hi to Alok, and then Venkat is also here, I believe. Yeah. So we are at a time when WhatsApp seems to be one of the guiding scientific principles of the mind. And in such times, to see this kind of a technical and scientific initiative, progressive initiative discussing solutions for the society is indeed very timely and obviously very much required. So today I plan to bring insights from my previous journey as a hygiene science leader and my present passion as a sustainable development business leader to this forum. What I want to do is present some ideas, some innovation questions, and really set up the audience to think about how we can move from where we are, because currently what we have in terms of hygiene solutions, be it soap or disinfectants, they are all of the yester century, as I would put it. And what could be those questions that can foray us into a new era is what I would be attempting to do this afternoon. So if you go to the next slide. There is adequate knowledge already on several aspects of soaps, detergents, cleaners, antimicrobials, and their efficacies against microorganisms and more specifically against viruses. In fact, as we speak, there is some preprint which is, I have put it in that left-hand side top corner, which is a review of overall all the materials that have been used for antiviral activity. So right from 1940, there have been several publications up until very recently on various agents that have antiviral activity. And if you go to the next slide, I have just put together some of the mechanistic understanding and the concentration and the types of materials that have been used for antiviral activity. Yeah, it appears that specifically for COVID-like viruses, which have an outer membrane, in addition to the capsid protein, there are different mechanisms of membrane rupture, elution and entrapment within detergent molecules and or compounds like quaternary ammonium compounds. And extensive work has also been done in the context of hand or presence of viruses on hand and how they can be removed by effective agents. So you will find some good information about various agents and their effectiveness in removal of COVID or COVID-like viruses from hands as well. So if I go to the next slide, the humble soap seems to be our biggest arsenal to fight COVID. Soap was invented few millennia ago, as early as 2800 BC. And in the 21st century, this has come handy in our fight against these viruses. So then my question was that, what is it that is required in terms of innovation with this humble soap that can help us achieve the balance between effective removal of pathogens, including COVID-like viruses, and an aspect that Professor Alok touched upon earlier is not to drain our environment with too much of burden for treatment of such chemicals in the water stream, wastewater stream. So if you go to the next slide, I'm presenting here different scenarios in which soap is used by us commoners. Yeah, one could be repairing our car and the hands get dirty with grease, or maybe kneading dough, which we have been doing quite often during the lockdown, and that needs soap to be kind of clean the hand. Also, if you think of meal times, you want to wash hands before meal and after meal. And then there are other times, such as one is outside having touched a shopping cart or a handle in a bus, or for that matter, used a toilet. In all these three different boxes type of scenarios, the soap use has a different endpoint in terms of removal of the dirt, or the target, as I would like to call it at this point of time. And that really brings me, if you move next, to this point that we need to now look at situational cleansing. Please keep the previous slide. We need to look at the situational cleansing of target dirt. Firstly, we should know what we would like to clean at that given instance. What is the quantum of the dirt that we want to clean? So whether we would be using this almost similar amounts of soap in removing grease from hands and removing viruses from hands when we have touched an external surface, for example. And also, perhaps a scientific understanding of the adherence characteristics of the target dirt that we are considering. Also, the role of water in cleansing is very, very important. What is it? How does hardness and ionic strength on impact the cleaning efficacy on skin and hands? Yeah, wettability and surface tension. I'm sure some of the speakers following this will touch upon that, because that is their expertise areas. Flow rates from the tap, because we need to conserve water, as well as impact of drying and wiping on cleaning and reintroducing infectious particles on skin can be something questions to be considered. So the next slide.
Dr. Nimish, one more minute.
Sure. Yeah. So next slide, I have just put forth some innovation challenges about soaps and detergents, and whether for visibly dirt-free hand washing, which primarily targets microbial removal, we should look at maximizing the spreading or penetration on hands and minimizing detergent and water use and ease of drying should be focused on. So that could result into reduced water consumption, lower load on wastewater treatment. And also, by the way, it is known that if the hand washing process is not very drudgery oriented, then it leads to improved hand wash compliance and therefore safer for human beings. Also, with the advances in digital IoT and AI related things, as well as sensors, there could be alerts, reminders that will ensure hand washing compliance. If you go to the next slide, I just skip this because this is just an overview on the antimicrobials and disinfectants. But just moving to my last slide then, as far as innovation considerations for antimicrobials and disinfectants are concerned, is that can we now start looking at these from the points of view of the user group? A healthy individual wants to be protected. An infected or recovered individual wants to prevent spread. And health workers who are have high exposure wants to be protected against exposure to infectious agents. So for all these three different groups, the kind of considerations for antimicrobials and disinfectants could be different. And what are we disinfecting? Is it only hands and skin, or is it fomites, or are we talking of built up spaces? And to deal with that, other factors that might need consideration is, are we talking of rapid action and inactivation of the disinfectant or a sustained action? The human safety issues and environment fate and risk, and the cost and ease of applications. And most important, and this is very, very critical, is standards, certifications, and regulatory issues regarding this, because we seem to be using disinfectants without necessarily having the right framing of the regulatory and standards. Because if you use a disinfectant generically from one application to the other, it could be hazardous. So I think these are some important considerations for use of disinfectants and their innovation, and I would like to stop with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nimish, for specific insights on several antimicrobials and disinfectants. And to understand what is the term SOAP is all about. And we found a lot of questions coming towards you also in the Q&A box in terms of whether SOAP is sufficient enough to kill germs or it is going to eliminate the virus. Some sort of questions have come like that. So we will take up the question answer later when we complete the four speakers. I hope you will be staying back after this speaker slots are over, so that we pose some questions to you, you can also answer them. So I would request Ramya to go to the next speaker, Dr. R. Venkat Raghavan. He's as you see in the profile, he's a platform leader in terms of clean choices at Unilever R&D and an adjunct faculty at IIT Palakkad. His work experience is in academy, industry, and business, and spanning several geographies across the world and with premier institutions like LG and so on. His research interests range from product design, engineering, material science, and environmental science, particularly focusing on water treatment and sustainable plastic use. So I would not again elaborate on the profile here, but I would request Dr. Venkat Raghavan to start his presentation, and we have another 10 minutes for you, sir, to make the presentation. Thank you.
So thank you very much. I want to thank Professor Pradeep and also colleagues like Alok and Nimish to be on this discussion today. I also see that every one of the other speakers before me have touched different aspects of detergents, soaps, and so on. I want to start with this little picture on the side, which is from a very old journal. And Israel Shvili is a professor, a chemical engineer, who's done a lot of work with surfactants. And that was actually the first book that I took when I joined Unilever as a scientist. I'm a platform leader for cleaner choices. You'll probably understand cleaner choices towards the end of the presentation. But the intention is really introduce to you what this area is and what can we do to make an ideal detergent. My next slide, please. So I'm going to spend a little bit of time when I say evolution of detergent. Actually, detergent is a very different term. Soap is essentially what was the original input in terms of cleaning that was there. And soap is a natural material. And as we moved from soap into laundry soaps, that's when we started to, you know, talk about detergents with the intention of what we call detergency of fabrics and many other, areas of work. If you look at the over the years, and this has been a story of almost now a century, where we started with synthetic detergents following laundry soap. Previously, you know, things used to be just boiled with caustic and so on. That is the way we used to do laundry when the input of chemicals began. And as we went through, we have gone to become call the same word detergent as being more and more sophisticated in the way of what they do, what are the chemicals that are involved, and what are the various benefits that they bring. So even if you simply looked at a detergent advertisement over the years, and you will remember, even in childhood, the Surf advertisement versus what you see today, they've evolved because the word detergent has evolved from an expectation of what consumers expect them to be. Next slide, please. So in the specific context of COVID, I know Nivish spoke a little bit about, the virus and the soap per se. So I thought it's worthwhile spending some time in understanding what is a virus and what does really a soap, detergent, or any of the hygiene products do with it, and why does it become so important. If we look at most viruses, they are either unenveloped or enveloped viruses. And when many of the viruses are enveloped viruses, so when you say envelope, all that is there surrounding the virus is a lipid bilayer. And while there's a hardy RNA inside, which does the damage once it enters your body, it's a very simple lipid bilayer that kind of, envelops and keeps it around with the physical integrity. So there are two ways in which you can attack and kill this virus. One is a simple physical action and other is a chemical action. The humble soap that the speakers ahead referred to is somewhat largely containing what is called a surfactant, which is a word coming from surface active agent. It goes in and it does two things. When we wash with soap, we do two things. Most of the viruses stick to a surface, and the surface could be your hand or any other surface, through some oily layer, because that's what they like. They are oil loving substances. They stick on oil, and through oil, like a glue, stick onto surfaces. What soaps do is they solubilize the oil away and simply wash away the attaching virus. That's one mechanism. What the soap or the surfactant in the soap or in the detergent does, it also kind of gets into the bilayer and breaks the lipid bilayer, because that also is essentially an oily based bilayer, because lipids are oils. And it then breaks the envelope apart. And once the envelopes break apart, it basically deactivates the virus. Similarly, in terms of chemical action, there is something called disinfectant. Now, disinfectant is a slightly higher level of requirement when it comes to, dealing with pathogens like viruses. What disinfectant does, they have specific compounds that can go and oxidize and break not only the bilayer, but even the constituent RNA and so on and so forth. So they actually go react and chemically break down the constituents, therefore in some way killing the virus. The alcohol works in two ways. It kind of takes the oil out and therefore works like a soap. But alcohol is also known to denature proteins, and therefore it works in both ways. So that's the understanding of the importance of a soap, detergent, and a hygiene product. They're all different, but they all kind of serve various services in different contexts. My next slide, please. So the question that was posed to me is, what is an ideal detergent? It also depends on when you ask this question. If you ask this question to a consumer 100 years ago, the detergent was only expected to do one thing, which is to clean clothes, which is what you see on the left. But today, if you look at a premium detergent that is used today, and even the ordinary detergent today, it not only has to clean fabrics, it has to remove stains. The clothes have to smell very well. Any malodor traces from the use of the fabric needs to be taken care of. The fabric must, in principle, be very hygienic to use. So things that bugs that are there on the fabric because of sweat and so on and the other body hygiene microbes that are coming from the body needs to be destroyed. The fabric needs to come into a shape. It shouldn't get stretched and lose its shape. So it must not have some shape control. It must have wrinkles. It must have softness. The cloth must feel good when you wear, not feel rough. So when you say what is an ideal detergent should do all of these. And that's what an ideal detergent is. So in terms of what the expectations are, whether it is a cleaning or a hygiene or a care, the detergent formulation has evolved from being a basic surfactant, which is what used to do cleaning, to what is called SRPs. These are soil removal polymers. These specifically go and attach to oil-water interfaces, modifying their contact angle and therefore allowing for release. There are antimicrobial agents in a detergent that go and attack the microbes that are there in the cloth. Or if you kind of leave the fabric for soaking for a long time, you see a dank malodor. That is being attacked by antimicrobials. Additionally, you have specialty polymers and even naturals which give a fragrance, which also give color, fastness and softness. Apart from this, there's also a format of convenience. There was a time when, you know, you used to get a bar of soap, which was also used for laundry, and used to cut them into pieces or use a grater to grate them into fine pieces and disperse them. But today you get a laundry detergent as a powder, you get laundry as a liquid, then you get specific formats like capsules and so on and so forth. These have hugely enhanced the convenience of use of a detergent powder or a modern detergent powder in the context of the hand wash, in the context of a washing machine, and so on and so forth. Therefore, the answer to what is an ideal detergent has really been a complex journey of innovation. It's not a simple question of saying what the detergent I was getting 50 years ago or 100 years ago, it's not the same. My next slide, please. But detergents also have a very healthy interaction with water. So therefore, when we talk about detergents, we cannot talk about detergents without their interaction with water. If you were to simply pour powder of detergent with fabrics and no water, you possibly can't expect any action for them to do. Therefore, water becomes an important media through which the surfactant, the chemicals, and all of those work with the fabric to give it all the functionality that I spoke about in the past slide. But when we talk about water, there are two important aspects of water. One is the quantity of water, which Professor Alok spoke about in terms of reuse, recycle, and other is the quality of the water. And the reality of today is both of these are a challenge. If you look at the quantity of water, you see that majority of the countries are already in stressed circumstances in terms of available water for usage. And it can only get worse. There is no real hope of it getting better unless all of us act responsibly. So what happens when the quantity of water is compromised? If you look at a chart here, you realize that much of our water consumption is around the key activities that enable human activity. Bathing, taking a largest portion of it. Use in toilets is another large portion. And fabric wash is the third important part of it. And these are almost equally consuming about 60% of our water requirement through the day. The challenge of having a very poor quantity of water is that you will do your washing lesser, which means that the hygiene impact that you will have will actually go up. The challenges of not being able to wash your sheets often will impact your health. The other aspect is the quality of water, which is generally directly impacts the whiteness of the fabric in a laundry context. Issues like the graying of the fabric, a white cloth or a white shirt no more remains white after a few washes, especially when, you know, in bad quality of water. So it leads to poor detergency, loses to surfactant loss because surfactant adhere to the particles of dirt that are there in the poor quality of water and are lost without being able to do the activity on the oily soil or the particulate soil that is there. there is yellowing of the fabric. This is essentially iron complexation. So iron in the water, which is always there, it's only iron. Deposits of the fabric.
Yeah, one more minute.
Yeah, I have just a couple of slides more. So in principle, all of the solutions lie in, you know, the addressing it through builders, through hard risk tolerance, surfactants, and sequestrants. My next chart, please. Yeah. However, for speaking for all of this, it's important to say, as we enhance the chemical load in the detergents to meet the important functionality, we must remember also the impact of detergent on the environment. So if you look at the Unilever mission, our mission is to make sustainable living commonplace. This was the original mission that was called out at the time of William Heskett Lever. But today we want to be a global leader in sustainable business. And therefore we've made very, very strong commitments on the environmental aspects of not just detergents, across all products that we make. The impact today of chemicals is in terms of CO2, in terms of the water that is consumed, and in terms of the waste generated through the packaging of these products. We very clearly called out that we will move out or kind of reduce the impact through use of non-virgin petrochemicals, reduce the use of single-use plastic, work on the wastage of waters. You are probably aware of semi-aqueous detergents that use low-foaming surfactants, that you can reduce one bucket of water less than most other detergents that are available, and in sense, reduce the net CO2 emission, because these can also take, surfactants can be active at lower temperatures and therefore you don't need to heat the water. And we have promised that we will move towards 100% renewable or circular feedstock, recyclability of the plastics, using water efficiency in all our products, being 100% degradable, and of course, energy efficiency and carbon capture. And that's where cleaner choices are. So all of us have a responsibility that while we ask for more from a detergent, we also ask that we do less impact to the environment. My last slide, please. So what are the challenges and outlook in the current scenario? So we all know that COVID-19 has impacted our lives in an unimaginable way. The word that we use is that we all need to have a new normal. Hygiene and water are intricately linked and important factors of human health. And similarly, detergents and hygiene products that we make help guarantee these. Therefore, the effort has to be to direct the enhance of efficacy and efficiency of the detergent, the modern detergent that I talked about, while limiting any adverse impact on the environment. So with that, I want to thank again the opportunities and the people who are listening, giving me this opportunity to talk. So thank you and stay safe.
Thank you, Dr. Raghavan. This was a great insight on the type of an ideal detergent, what it would be. And learning from you and Professor Alok Dhawan and Dr. Nimish Shah, I think we should get into something called detergent policy also, if it is possible for this country. I don't know whether other countries have already put something like that. But I think we were discussing when we were privately discussing some time back on detergent policy. I don't know whether you were saying this is not the right context to discuss this, but we would again think of a separate call with you on taking up this in terms of what would be an ideal detergent. And, you know, trying to do two things. One is the water conservation through a proper detergent for effective disinfection. And the second thing is, in terms of when you use an effective detergent, what would be the type of loads that we can reduce in the wastewater streams that we are trying to generate? So these probably are some of the questions that I'm getting right now. And we have around 45 to 50 questions already, you know, cropped up. What I would do is, again, take these questions during the Q&A. I request all the participants to keep asking questions to the right panelists whom you would like to ask. And I would like to move on to the next speaker, Mr. Venkatesh Devasigamani, who's been a friend for a long time with me when I was with the earlier organizations. And he has kindly put in his time to, you know, share something with us on the environmental impact. Just like what we said a few seconds ago, that two aspects we need to take care of. One is the water conservation angle, and the second aspect is, once you generate this wastewater, how do you really manage this? So I would request Mr. Venkatesh, who's been a pioneer in water treatment technologies across the country and the world, particularly in the textile belt of Tirupur, garments belt of Tirupur. So I would request Mr. Venkat to do his presentation, please.
Good evening, one and all. I wish to thank Mr. Professor Pradeep for giving me this opportunity, and also Sripadi, and also my fellow panelists and the participants. Yeah, can you move on to the next slide? I wish to take through the water treatment prospect. The hygiene practice is impacting us with impacts like quantum of water increase, quantum of surfactants in the water, and also the antimicrobial agents in the water. So we have to treat this the current scenario.
Venkat, you're in mute. You have to unmute.
Yeah. Oh, it's okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Let me add, can you move on? Back. So you can see the table here where the water consumption before COVID in on an average urban areas, it is around 70 liters, in some cases even 110 liters, which is way lower in compared to the international standard. But due to COVID, it is estimated to go up to 95. It means until 35% of increase in the water consumption, which is mainly coming from washing and also the washing of hands and clothes. Next slide. Move on. As Professor Pradeep told in the earlier, in the international standard, the consumption of detergent is somewhere around 11 kg per person per annum. But in India, before COVID, it was measured as 2.7 kg to 3.5 kg per annum per person, which results to 3 to 7 milligram per liter of surfactants in the effluent. You can see in the other slide, it contributes to 5.5 actually, but in real, with all the dilution, it comes even in 3 to 7. This is a study made over a period of 21 months. After COVID, this is expected to go to 5 kg per annum, which means it is going to be 5 to 9 milligram per liter in the water, in the wastewater. Move on. As everyone knows, there are few impacts because of this detergents and surfactants in the water bodies. One is increase in algae blooms, and the second one is depletion of oxygen level, which is going to result in death of species, and lower surface tension of the water. It has been studied by J.F. Fairchild that it is 0.36 milligram per liter is not impacting. Beyond that, there is an impact in the water bodies. Next slide. Next slide. Keep moving. This is a typical water treatment plant which is installed across the world, also in India specifically. It is consist of primary, which comes with a bar screen, then primary settling and collection tank, followed by secondary, that is an SBR or MBBR technology mostly used, and followed by a plate settler, then followed by a tertiary treatment with pressurized sand filter, activated carbon filter or dual media filter, and finally it is polished with or disinfected with chlorination. Next slide. Now the impact of this usage, higher usage, is going to impact the water treatment process. It has been estimated that the pH value is going to go up. Until now, the pH range is somewhere around 6.5 to 7.5. And now it is going to go beyond 8.2 pH. So this is one part which is very important, because of the alkali-based detergents and disinfectants are going to impact the pH value. The second more for surfactants in the aeration system, it is going to form more foams, which is going to impact the process of biological treatment. Third is the organic load. Even the load is also increasing because of the surfactants, and which is going to decrease the plant efficiency, which is not designed for. Next slide. You can see two graphs on the side. Probably it is smaller, sorry for this. See the on the left hand side, you can see the impact of surfactants per milligram, every 0.1 milligram. The bottom line is without any surfactants. The second bottom line is with 0.1 ppm of surfactants, how much load of COD it is increasing. You can see it starts from 800 COD in a 24-hour retention time, where it results in 150 COD in the first graph. The second graph, you can see 0.01 ppm is impacting almost nothing. It is fine. 0.15 is also is impacting until 300 ppm. But when it goes beyond 2 ppm and 3 ppm, 0.2 and 0.3 and 1 ppm at the top, you can see it is increasing the load from 800 to 1600 COD. It means the organic load increase in the STP because of the surfactants is going to be larger. The second graph shows you the oxygen exchange rate due to the surfactants. Again, you have the same ratio of surfactants listed here. Until 0.02 ppm, there is no impact. But beyond that, you can see even there is a depletion of oxygen transformation in the system. So these are going to impact the water treatment plant, which is designed with earlier system. And for today, it is going to be totally different. Next slide. As most of the industrialists or the government officials knows why they have chosen SBR or USBR, these two technologies are good at two points. One is the CapEx, capital investment, because of the smaller tank capacity, and also less space needed for treating of water. But is it serving the purpose? Let's see. Please, Ramya. You can see two graphs here. I have specified two. One is on the left side is activated sludge process. This is a continuous aeration system. And the other one is USBR, which is a normally used technology, or you can call it as an SBR technology. The surfactants detrition in case of activated sludge process, we can reach until 99% of removal of surfactants in activated sludge process. But in case of SBR, it is only 30%. This is because it is sulfur is only taken into detrition in case of USBR, but in activated sludge process, it is going to be until 99%. Next slide. So what are the ways we can handle the situation? The first one is much easier, pH. pH has to be corrected. If the pH is around 8.2 or even more, we can reduce the pH by dosing of acid into the system and keep this around 6.5 to 7.5, which is very good for the efficiency of the biological process. But the most important part is the pre-oxidation, because this system is mostly not available in the existing scenario. It is very important with the usage of such a large surfactants from 0.3, 0.4 ppm to almost very close to 1 ppm is going to be a big problem. So we have to aerate the system, pre-aerate the system so that the surfactants can be partially removed before getting into the biological process.
We have one more minute, sir.
Yeah, I'm already there. Then my suggestion is it's better to look into a perfect scientific solution rather than going for a dual media filter or any other system, because it removes a part. The limitation of this system is it can cut off the micron size until 60 micron even the best of the condition, it is going to be 40 micron. But in case of ultrafiltration or MBR technology, it can be reduced to 0.01 micron to 0.03 micron. So it can, in this case, all the viruses and bacteria are already retained into the system and it is not getting into the water bodies. Next. Now you can see the two pictures. One is left side, it is an MBR system, and the right side, it is an ultrafiltration system. Can you move on, Ramya? Yes. You can see here the cutoff of ultrafiltration. It is only 0.01 micron cutoff size, which will ensure that this pollutant of viruses cannot get into the water body and it cannot reach back us again into our washing or any other system. So I once again thank you everyone for this opportunity, and I wait for my questions to answer. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Mr. Venkatesh, for a brief insight into the environmental impact and the mitigation measures that we have in hand. For the benefit of participants, there is a poll also being run simultaneously along with this webinar. People who may view this could put their questions and answer these polls and use this poll for a better understanding of the subject. And now, since we are having three panelists right now, we are expecting Mr. Sitaraman to join shortly, but we have Dr. Manoj, Mr. Monish Bhandari, and Deepthi from as a panelist. So before that, I would request Professor Pradeep, if you have any questions for the speakers right now.
Well, I would like to first of all apologize for the power cut. We are living in this country, and of course we have this problem. We have to live with it. I want to bring up a couple of points here, which the panelists as well as the speakers should consider. Waste ultimately reaches the sewerage system, and that in India, we have sewerage system only, well, treating just about 30% of our wastewater is treated. So this exists only, this sort of sewerage system exists only in the cities. We have 65% of the people living in rural areas. So obviously there is a large environmental load that goes into our villages. As a kid, all the waste in our home, well, soap and detergents I'm talking about, that essentially nourished the coconut trees in my parental home. So this is precisely what is happening in India. So the rural load is significantly high. And it is quite important to realize that the impact on the rural ecosystem will be felt over some time. And that, of course, rural produce comes to the city. So obviously that's an aspect that we need to consider. We have brought up this issue of water, impact of detergents on water and detergent policy. So obviously we are talking about a water cost associated with a detergent, or a detergent has an environmental cost, which is largely a cost on the water system. And the last speaker also brought up this particular thing. So how do we quantify this? So that ultimately we have a mechanism of evaluating this, putting that on the product. Now, India is largely rural. Rural people also have to have products which can disinfect them. So none of these policies and programs that we talk about should increase the burden, the economic burden on the village. and the villagers. So that calls for a completely different kind of innovation. I want to bring up these aspects which have come up in different ways in this discussion, but in a coherent fashion. That's all that I would like to say, Mr. Sripathi.
Thank you, Professor. Now, I would take up a few questions that we have got through in the Q&A box till our other panelists also join. We are expecting Manoj also to join. He has some network issues, as Professor Pradeep, you have been mentioning. So I'll take up this time for another 2 to 3 minutes. We can get some questions put across to the expert speakers. I have a few questions which I noted down during the Q&A session. The first question I would like to pose it to Professor Dhawan. There were some questions on how do we really put these solutions that you indicated onto the implementation level. There are several barriers that are still existing in terms of putting these solutions into sustainable usage in the existing conditions. That was one question, Professor. Would you like to answer now?
Yes, I think I answered it online to the gentleman as well, but I think it's a good idea to discuss it. I think for these novel solutions that are coming up, we've had discussions at the government level as well. The way to propagate this or to immediately get it on the field is only two ways. Of course, the industry does its bit to propagate it, but the fact that there are other solutions, the market makes it difficult for the new companies or new products in the market to take, it takes its time. I think the best method that we could think of was, especially for these reasons where CSR funds are also available through the big corporate. The government is willing to facilitate the deployment of these technologies as long as we can get some CSR funds to be made available for newer technologies that are getting into the market. I think that's how I see that they can be quickly upscaled and be brought to the market. I mean, they are there with the licensees, they are there in the market, but to bring them up in bigger numbers, I think that is one thing. The other that we have discussed again at the government level is to ensure that the newer technologies that are coming can be made available to the masses, especially two or three ways. One, we can have these technologies put in schools, and of course, once they're tested and validated, we should put them up in schools and hospitals, which have a large population coming every day, and they need good clean drinking water all the time. Of course, the next would be with the fact that now plastic bottles are no more allowed, you can actually put these kind of newer devices or newer systems on railway platforms. I think these are the way to go. And with the fact that the Honorable Prime Minister said we'd like to take Swadeshi and become more and more self-sustainable, self-reliable on various platforms, I think it'll be a good juncture that we are discussing all these, and perhaps we'll find a mechanism to upscale these technologies.
So one more question, Professor. Does graphene oxide act as disinfectant? That was one question.
Oh, that's a good one. Actually, graphene oxide should be able to disinfect, but I'm not sure to what level. There's one more question about nano sort of formulations that...
Nano formulation, yeah.
Yeah, so what I was thinking, I mean, few things that have been tested. One is, of course, silver nanoparticles, then titanium dioxide nanoparticles and ruthenium. So they have been tested. Silver, of course, has been tried and tested very well. We even have a candle filter that is having these kind of nanoparticles. And one more question that has come up is related to ozone. Why ozone is, or can ozone be used, especially in the trap that is beneath the sink, and it would be much better than using carbonaceous material. But what stops us from doing that, I think perhaps is to do with more to do with the environmental issues, and also how we ensure that it's safe while it is treating the water. Maybe perhaps the other speakers who were there, especially from Unilever, or maybe Pradeep himself can allude to that as well.
Thank you, Professor. There was a question to Dr. Nimisha. Does soap kills germs, or just it removes, or it eliminates from the surface? Dr. Nimisha, are you there? I think he's left the call. So if anyone would like to attend this question.
So I think this was there, the slides that I presented. I think I had a whole slide on how a soap works, how an antimicrobial works. So soap does wash away the detergent by wash away the virus, but it also breaks the envelope around it, by which it deactivates the virus. So soap does a fairly good job of taking care of the virus. Of course, disinfectants will do it to a greater level, but I think soaps are good enough from that's what we've learned, especially with the COVID virus.
Thank you, Dr. Venkatraghavan. There are two more questions. I would like to put it right now and take it to the panelists immediately. Many people are asking, does alcohol kill RNA, or it just sequences the RNA in the streams? To Dr. Venkatraghavan.
So it is known that alcohol denatures most of these by actually using the hydrogen bond. So it doesn't break and resequence the DNA, but many of the RNA and DNA can get denatured because the hydrogen bonding activity can be broken down, and then it makes it ineffective. But whereas disinfectants that oxidize and break down also leave the same effect, but through a different mechanism.
Thank you. There was another very common question which we keep asking ourselves. Does high foam generated give effective disinfection? That was one question. And what would be the load on the streams, STP loads and so on, if phosphates are added more and more in detergents? And do the algae bloom increase because of the presence of phosphates?
Is this to Mr. Venkat, I'm presuming?
Yeah, this is to Dr. Venkatraghavan again.
Oh, to me? Okay. I think what was your first part of the question?
High foaming is effective.
So I think foam is an essential aspect of a surfactant. So surfactant does two things. It reduces the surface tension. That's why it's called a surfactant.
Yep.
When you reduce the surface tension of a water-air interface, automatically it's easy to form a bubble, and therefore foam happens. So foam is a kind of a consequence of the fact that there is a surfactant. So it's not necessarily essential. But the reason you use low foaming surfactants is because the rinsing that you do post washing is essentially to take the foam out. So when you have a low rinsing, low foaming surfactant, you can save the rinse water, and therefore the overall efficiency of use of water becomes better. That's the whole purpose of a low
foaming. Thank you, Dr. Venkatraghavan. Thank you.
One point that I may want to add, Sripathi, is that there is a person from Africa, Igor Moses, who has a question from Uganda. If there is a possibility that you could connect him live at some point in this,
I would request Ramya to do that if possible. Ramya, is it possible for you to connect him?
At some point, I'm just raising him. Yeah.
So meanwhile, let me have one more question to Dr. Venkatesh or Mr. Venkatesh, who's been doing on the water treatment. There is a question on what is AOP? What are AOPs, and does AOP really help in water treatment or the sewage treatment? That is one question. The second question is, what would be pH correction that is required in water treatment? So these two questions I would like to pose it to Mr. Venkatesh.
I think it is ASP, not AOP.
The question is AOP as typed by that person.
Okay. Activated sludge process is a normal biological process where you have an extended aeration or short aeration system where you have an activation of biological bacteria for the treatment process. It's not a batch process, it's a continuous process, which is in terms of a sewage treatment plant, most of the plants are batch process. In terms of pH has to be neutral. We have to maintain a pH around 6.5 to 7.5, by which this is a more suitable and efficient bacterial growth, biological growth and degradation.
One more question, Mr. Venkatesh. There is a question on, do you see a major problem with organic overload on WTP, STP due to recent increase in soaps and detergents? How are we going to handle this?
See, of course, so this I already addressed this particular point. This load has to be, we have to handle it with two ways. One is pre-oxidation. Because of pre-oxidation, you can decrease the load. And the best way of handling is only activated surge process. Now, or with the existing system, you have to have a prolonged process time. Batch process now, the batch process around 3 to 4 hours of treatment, which has to be enhanced to 6 hours probably. Then the load of hydraulic load has to be lower. We have a challenge now.
Thank you, Vandesh. So, Ramya, you were able to get that person online?
Sripati? No, not yet.
Okay, I'll do that.
Okay.
Sripati, also K. Sitaram wanted to make a point.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm just making him come online.
Yeah, we have other panelists also waiting now.
So, shall we proceed with the panel? And the...
I would suggest we'll complete the panel discussion first.
Yes.
By the time we get the others online, I would request the panelists to join right now. I would request Mr. Sitaraman to make his points, please.
Okay.
The next slide. Thank you.
Hi.
Mr. Sitaraman has been with Unilever, just a short introduction to him. And he's been with the R&D business and several innovations that have been happening in Unilever. And we recently met at ICCW also for several things that we could do together. I would not again take much time from Mr. Sitaraman. Mr. Sitaraman, please go ahead to make your points.
Yeah, so I think, thanks, Dr. Sripati. I think the key areas that I wanted to talk about was largely in the area of detergents and the overall wash process. As all of you know that the entire wash process is very important in this whole area of disinfection. So it's not just the detergent alone. So the way you do the post-treatment of the clothes is also important. So a fabric conditioner, for instance, can also leave. It's a cationic detergent that you use, and it is an important element which can give you and your clothes a long-lasting protection. In terms of the layer that it leaves on your clothes, in addition to the other benefits that it can give. So this is one habit which many of our consumers use fabric conditioners in their daily wash process. So it's a routine that has got embedded with many of them, especially in South India. So one of the challenges that we can really look at is how can we encourage the use of fabric conditioners, which in apart from protecting the clothes can also give them a good disinfection or kind of an antibacterial benefits as we go along. So that is one area which I wanted to highlight. The other area is, again, the whole point about use of hot water during soaking, then again, use of any good quality detergent. You know, so again, detergents is very widely used, but then again, the amount of detergent that you use is also critical, you know. So it's not just the type of detergents that you use, but it's also about the quantity or the grams per liter of the soap solution and the overall wash process, which becomes extremely important in A, giving the functional benefit of cleaning, as well as in terms of giving us an effective disinfection. I'm sure Dr. Venkat Raghavan would have covered in his presentation about an ideal detergent and all of that. So I don't want to repeat that whole thing, but I just wanted to bring these two or three important areas into play. And if there are any questions, I'm more than happy to take them.
Thank you, Mr. Sitaraman, for the brief thoughts that you have shared. I would request the next panelist, Ms. Deepthi, to share her thoughts. I have Dr. Manoj and Monish also in the next set of panelists. I would request Deepthi to join and share her thoughts on how this subject of disinfection through detergents and chemicals is possible.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Sripati.
So I would like to thank ICCW for having me on this program. It's become an essential need to have a safe drinking water or a proper sanitation hygiene and to maintain a waste management for a healthy living, not only during this pandemic, but also for our future. So I would like to bring out a few points where the disinfectant used for the water disinfection, either be in the drinking water disinfection or in the wastewater management. So the commonly used disinfectant are chlorination, or apart from that, we do see ozonization or UV filter disinfection. And there is this chlorine dioxide disinfection, which is also used for water disinfection. So having said that, I would like to share my experience when I was, I would like to share my experience when, you know, when I visited this couple of ACP plants in and around Chennai. So the three major challenges that these communities are facing. First, they lack in the proper ACP treatment plant, and the water, the wastewater is not treated. It is just let it out and then in turn contaminating the groundwater. There's a third point where the dosage, proper disinfection is an issue, because the dosage process is not optimized and it is not efficient enough in treating the microbes efficiently. So as I was talking about chlorine dioxide, so I mainly deal with chlorine dioxide for water disinfection. It is a very highly oxidizing agent, which is five times effective compared to chlorine. And unlike chlorine, it doesn't react with any of the organic compounds. So we know chlorine, when used for water disinfection, it reacts with organic compounds and halogenated byproducts are formed. But with chlorine dioxide, it doesn't react with organic compounds and it is pH independent. So when we are talking, this chlorine dioxide, being a pH independent, we can give a low dosages. We don't have to increase our dosages, unlike when we're going for chlorination. And when it enters into the water stream, it is environment friendly. It will just degrade into a common salt, and sustainability is there. So what I would like to say here is, for a proper disinfectant to disinfect the water system, you should have an optimum dosage and environment friendly. Sustainability should be important, and this will also help our future generation by maintaining our ecosystem. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Deepthi. I couldn't introduce you in the beginning. Sorry for that. Deepthi has been working in a startup, MicroGo LLP in Chennai, and she has been working on several products that can solve some water contamination disinfection crisis. And we would like to talk to you later on, Deepthi, in terms of how do we utilize these set of products for the betterment of the society on a long run. So I would request Dr. Manoj, if you are available right now, you had some issues on the internet and power supply. Would you like to share your thoughts?
Yeah, I'm here. Good evening to all. And first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Sripathi for inviting me for this previous event. I will begin from one word that Deepthi has mentioned, optimum doses. So the thing is that how we are using, by using different kinds of mechanism or equipment, or you can say any kind of instrument, that these disinfectants or any soaps, okay? So the thing is that optimum doses are much more important than any kind of disinfectant and what we use. Optimum doses can be used by efficient equipments. Usually you have seen all the agricultural sprayers have been employed in disinfection spraying, but maybe they are not meant for spraying the disinfectant. Okay, but trend has gone there, and almost all the agricultural sprayers that has been used for agriculture pesticide or agrochemical spraying has been employed in you can say disinfection purposes. So how efficient system is, then you will be able to minimize these losses and you may give a optimum dosage. So one of the thing is that Professor Dhawan has mentioned, that is electrostatic spraying technology. This is the one of the most efficient and effective technique to generate you can say mist or any fog kind of things of any disinfectant and sanitizer. In electrostatic spraying, basically we charge the spray and then spray. So charged droplets are more prone to you can say attracted by any surface. Usually all the viruses, pathogens are you can say to save themselves, they hide underside of the any surface or you can say unexposed area. When you spray, then almost all the disinfectant or sanitizing material goes off the target and it is not efficient, you can say. So how to increase the efficiency? Electrostatic is one of the most efficient method. What we do usually, we reduce the size. In electrostatic spray, when you charge, there is certain limit of any droplet and it bursts. So bigger droplets burst into dot of droplets and it generates thousands of droplets from one more bigger droplets. Okay. So now imagine where one droplet was going to one place and now thousands of droplets are going to the same surface and how efficient that system is. So usually no conventional systems are available in the market which can generate the droplet size around 50 micron or maybe 10 micron, you can say. Agricultural sprayers are mostly in the range of more than 150 micron. So 150 micron droplet generation is not enough to kill or any virus. You have seen many people are washing the wall and throwing it out by some fire vehicles and sprayers. So that is the not efficient solution. You have to generate the droplet size in the range of that microbes or microorganism or you can say any other bacteria. Then only it is more efficient rather than any system. So optimum dose is one of the most important tasks. And this technology right now available with the three companies that we have transferred recently. Although we have developed this technology way ahead in November 2019 when there was no corona, but later on we have shifted it to in some mission mode and we have put this technology with three industries. One is the different brand names are available, e-spray, you can say micro sprayer, and another one is in-C sprayer. Okay, so these are the three companies which are providing these such systems in the market.
Thank you Dr. Manoj for your quick insights into the electrostatic liquid atomization that is very much essential for optimal dosages. I think we'll have to explore more on this aspect for the current crisis that is existing. I would request Mr. Monish, who is our next panelist. Ramya, can you take it to the next slide for Monish Bhandari? And Mr. Monish Bhandari, he is a director for SS Med World. And he has several, he has developed several water disinfection systems. And particularly now, he's working on certain things called biomedical waste management, which is again going to be a huge cause of concern now. I would not take much time from my side. I would request Mr. Monish to share his thoughts, please.
Good evening, and you've been having a great session. I've been moving in and out of this. I've heard Manoj speaking and Shripati is doing a great job. So, we are slightly different from what you've been discussing. So we have developed a technology along with Professor Alok Dhawan from CSIR IITR. And we are using microwaves. We are using microwave for sterilization. Recently, the AIIMS Jodhpur has validated our technology as the best technology for reuse of N95 and PPE kits. So that is one new thing that we've done with sterilization, where we sterilize at 60 degrees Celsius as compared to a general autoclave sterilization, which is at 135 degrees. So that's for sterilization across the board. Besides this, we've also developed a methodology of disinfecting lab effluent. Now, I was explaining Shripati the other day that lab effluent coming out of various labs. Now, you've got labs at almost every corner of a marketplace. So it's more like a provision store everywhere. Now, what does the lab do to all its effluent that comes out in terms of unused samples and petri dishes and all kinds of stuff which could be seriously dangerous? You have a lot of positive samples there. So you can't actually drain it out into a drain and think that it's all sorted. So we have this small modular device, which is a smart sink. So it's more like a sink, which you use in your bathrooms. But the only difference is it is stainless steel with a small box at the bottom, which can be placed into every lab, which can take care of all your effluent coming out of the lab. And when the exit port can be put into the drain, and the levels of disinfection are validated as per the CPCB guidelines. So that is another process which we have in place. And if you would give me a little time, you can unstart screen while the other part. Oh, you got a screen on. So that's about us. And in case you have any questions or something, I can help you with.
We will have to come back to you, Mr. Monish, on specifics. And already we have overshot our time, but nevertheless, it's been a great discussion that is going on. And I would request Mr. Moses Egger, who's been listening to us and he's trying to ask some question from Uganda.
Okay, great.
Ramya, would you like to ask him to come online?
Yeah, he is online. He is supposed to speak.
Yeah,
can you hear us? Yeah.
Yes, please. Thank you very much. And thank you, Professor Pradeep, for this conference. My question is maybe to the first presenter, that is Professor Locke. I was asking whether, you know, there is, when you consider a villager and when you are talking about evaluation of the effectiveness of a detergent, someone would think that its ability to froth, the ability of a particular detergent to generate more foam or more froth is related to its cleansing effectiveness. So my question would be, how would you, first of all, what do you add to a detergent to reduce its frothing ability, yet maintaining its effectiveness? But also, how do you balance this with acceptability among the users of this detergent? Thank you.
So I couldn't hear the last part. I think the first part was, so there are already companies that have now come up with detergents that do not create froth. And I think the expert from Unilever also alluded to the same. And they essentially are using it to reduce the water load, and you can actually wash your clothes with much less water, because you have to sort of otherwise take off all the foam as well. So I think the second part of your question was not very clear to me. I couldn't hear the audio. I'm not sure what
Ramya was. The second part was like the frothing ability is related to, okay, so a local person would perceive it as related to the effectiveness of this detergent.
At least in places where we were scarce of water, people appreciated the fact that we were able to come up with a detergent which does not have foaming in it. So I think it depends on the area in which you are there, and perhaps if you are in an area which is deprived of water, people will immediately appreciate the fact that they have to use maybe half the amount of water. And I think Pradeep is sort of almost up there to wanting to give a comment as well. Pradeep? You're muted, Pradeep.
First of all, Igor is asking this question from a remote part of Uganda. And I'm so glad that we can connect people to such places? Igor, that was a nice question. And villagers would like to know this, what exactly a scientist's answer would be. Froth will be confused with its disinfection capacity. I would like Venkat Raghavan to comment on this. I am not in a position to comment on.
So Igor, I think I appreciate the fact that, I don't know what the time is, but in this time zone, you've chosen to join us. I think very commendable, the intent to learn. So I think froth is something that, is a human response. You know, washing your hand, right? There is a sense of creaminess when you wash your hands with a bubble and a soap that comes when you wash. What happens is that preference also gets transferred to when you're trying to wash fabric. The reality is that froth is in some sense unavoidable because they are both surfactants, and surfactants, when you kind of agitate them with water, will always provide foam. But it's also a consumer preference. So some consumers like the fact that they want to see foam during the detergency. But at the same time, like Professor said, for some of them, when the water is, they're in a stressed condition, they really don't want to see foam because they have to keep on, additionally adding water. Remember, the lady of the house in many of the, nations has to carry a bucket of water to at least 3 or 4 kilometers. When you ask to carry an additional bucket of water to do her laundry, you can see the pain. And that's why low rinse kind of, surfactants and the detergents that are low rinse are the kind of the need for the day when you want to deal with water stress. So that's the intent. This was not there many, many years ago. We were not able to balance the foaming versus the anti-foaming. But as we kind of understand science, there are specialist anti-foaming agents that are there in the detergent that kind of manage this very well. It becomes very technical to explain it beyond this. But essentially, there is science that has gone into saying, how do we control the foam while not ensuring that the detergency comes down? Yeah.
Okay.
So we have Professor K. Sitaraman, who's joining now from Tokyo. Ramya?
Thank you. I think it's exciting. For congratulations for another very, very successful second webinar. Today's discussion was actually quite techie heavy, and I think we covered a lot of ground on detergent and disinfectant. The message from a policymaker angle, which is what I think I want to leave some of the participants may be interested, is that, we spoke a lot about having clean water and then having water to clean ourselves. The remaining challenge is, do we leave the water clean after we have used it? So that is the problem we have. If every drop can be used, which is initially clean, and then we use it to clean, and then if we know how to leave it clean, and then we have really solved this water cycle problem. It is similar to like getting a house on rent. You get it from the owner. After you used it, you have to give it back nearly in the same condition as we originally got it when we started on rent. So water use, the detergents and the methods that we use, all these have to take into account. There's a price that is attached to that, and we have to be willing to pay that price. I think a crisis like this actually makes us aware of the price and the technologies that we need to use, because those will come if we're willing to pay for that. Just today, very timely, all the international financing organizations together with the WHO have just announced that in the context of the pandemic, we should prioritize investing in water and sanitation and hygiene, and they've pledged lots of dollars. I think there's a great opportunity now to capture this. Let me leave it with that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sitaraman, for your insights. And now I would request Ramya to make concluding remarks. And before she makes her concluding remarks, I would thank all the experts, the speakers from all over the country, and the several participants who have been joining this. I would like to thank them for the time they have taken to join this session. Ramya, it's over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Sripathi. And I would like to start with what Professor said, where sewage systems are used to nourish coconut trees. And I think that is one dream area where we can lead our country with these discussions and implementations. So, okay. sorry for that. I would like to thank my team, Professor Pradeep, Mr. Sripathi, Mr. Nandakumar, who have been very supportive in organizing this webinar series, and our speakers, Professor Alok Dhawan, Dr. Venkat Raghavan, Dr. Nimish Shah, Mr. Venkatesh, and our panel members, Mr. Sita Raman, Ms. Deepthi, Mr. Monish, and Mr. Manoj Patel. Thank you for your time and
We have a vote of thanks due from Dr. T.N.B.B. Rao, who's our advisor, ICCW.
Yes, yes. I would like to take him over and just emphasize on what Mr. Professor Sita Raman said, that this is a good time to invest in water, sanitation, and hygiene. So I look forward to having you all in our next symposium on water and hygiene. Now, Dr. T.N.B.B. Rao, please.
Yeah, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak at the last. Actually, it was a very great seminar, and a lot of people have joined here, and a lot of insights. And as a profession, I'm actually working for the last 30 years in the field of water treatment and also formulation of detergents and cleaning liquids. So I learned a lot from this seminar, and we would like to, on behalf of ICCW, we would like to thank one and all for this participation. And only one point I wanted to mention here is, when we are talking about the water saving on disinfection, detergents and all, and there are some recent literature saying that UV light at less than 220 nanometers, which is safe to hands and eyes, but it can use for disinfection. Generally, UV light we use is 254 nanometers UVC, which is not good for skin and eyes. But some literature says below 220 nanometers, which can be used for disinfection without any effects. Maybe we can look into such aspects. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. For the benefit of participants and the speakers, this would be available as a recording on the YouTube channel also. So we would urge you to log on to it and get a clear understanding of how the session went on. This will be available as a link. Once we conclude this call, we will be posting it again to you with email. Thank you all speakers, Mr. Venkat, Ms. Deepthi, Monish, Dr. Manoj, even though you had interruptions in the electricity and internet, thank you for staying with us. If you have any specific queries, we'll again be ready to answer that in our emails, and we request you to urge you to join for the third meeting also. As Ramya mentioned, we have the third meeting on water and hygiene as a topic, so we urge you to join. Thank you once again for your participation and your support within a short notice. Thank you all.